episode of Finno-Grip Mashing, we are going to remake this shaft. This is really embarrassing a little bit. The Morse 2 taper inside here has too much runout. Really too much. Well, now that we have the new forge or chuck, I cannot blame anything. The only one who I can blame if it still has run out when I now redo it is this guy here. Yeah. Okay, but well, this episode actually has a section of how to operate forge or chuck. This is hopefully this is informative. It's not well, if you are familiar with the forge or chuck operation, then just skip this portion. It's well, of course you do if you don't like that. And yeah, okay, but let's go in and start dialing in this piece of material that I already got to suitable length. So, how to operate this kind of animal? First of all, you need to put your stock into there. Of course you want to minimize your work effort later on, and you can actually look at your workpiece and what's the suitable diameter here. Lines here, these are not decorations. They are there to assist you in making the chuck keys symmetric, the jaw symmetric when you install your work. So I'm putting them somewhere around that I know which is suitable. I'm not looking the jaw here, I'm looking this edge and the line. So okay, then you put in your piece there about in the center, and then you okay, it's around there. So now I adjust every jaw to about the same place. Okay, it's still quite loose. And then what I will do, I will now tighten them very slightly. Not fully, every jaw a little bit. Okay, now it's no more loose. And you can see it's already quite center. Yeah. So with just the lines you can adjust it quite near to center. And then, well, the stick out in this case, because we are going to drill a hole, we need to center it and whatever. I could put it like, let me demonstrate you, I could put it like this and tighten it there, and then dial in using just the very edge of this one. And what would happen? I wouldn't know anything about the whipslash. So there are two things you need to worry about with these chucks. One is that it's running in the center. But then it could be running like, it could be running like this, you still could get one point where it looks like it's good. But when you have a stick out somewhat like this, when you are dealing with a virgin workpiece, you put some stick out, so when you measure it in 2 points, then you can be quite sure that there is no whipslash and it is centered. So this is hardened material, and the jaws are hardened. So in this kind of situations you always need to use backing. These are flattened copper tube. So I will put one on every slot here, like that. And now I would also like to have, because these have a tendency to drop, so now they don't go down. So I have, I use packing, and this one has the function, two functions. It protects the surfaces, the workpiece surface, but it also, in this case, because this is hardened, it protects the jaws as well. So it isolates them from each other. That is very... If you want to protect your surface, you always use packing. Another function of the packing is that it flexes. So you can actually take out the runout. If you don't use packing, well, you cannot adjust your runout, because these jaws don't flex. So, and now I just put one packing under every jaw. Okay, let's see now. That's really low, 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 low. That's also low. Twenty-eight, 14. Round there. Okay. So this one needs to be tightened. It's quite tight already. This one needs to be loosened. This one needs to be loosened a little bit. Okay, the maximum is, again, it's 5, is it? No, it's 4, so in 2, like that. This one needs to be tightened, tightened, and there you are. And now, let's move here. Now this should be easier to do. So that's high now. That's high. So, yeah, it's a lot easier. Because, well, it's not easy. That's high. I probably hammered it to the wrong direction. So, okay. That's high. Oh yeah, I can see it actually moving. It's moved so easily. So that's high now. That is high, so... Yeah, it's... That's high. Well, it moves too easily. These are probably loose. Some of these is loose, I believe. That was loose. So that's high. Okay, we are within something. Let's go back to here. Like that. So that's our minimum. 18. So 9. That needs to be tightened. That 2. Okay. Go back here. Now this jaw is high. Helped. Now the high point is at this place. Now it's here. Okay. Yeah. This jaw needs tightening. Hopefully I can get the final 100ths away from there. I could, actually. Yeah. And now back here. Yeah, we are still good. Now, at this point, at the end. Wait a minute. At the end we have a deviation like this. It's well, about 1/100 of a millimeter altogether. Then when we go near here, we have the same. Okay, now I'm facing this thing and I'm locked the carriage. So I will be feeding manually with the compound, and well, we need to take really light cuts here now. Quite a lot of stick out, and yeah. Now comes the easy part, because now I'm going to center drill it. Center drilling doesn't introduce any side forces, and then I will drill it. And we are still not introducing any radial forces here. So, yeah. Okay, setting the Morse 2 taper angle into the compound, and well, yeah, okay. So I have done some calculations, and well, here are the results of some searching. So the angle is actually 1 degree 25 minutes 49 seconds, which is about that much in degrees. And then a sine from that is like that, so if you round it up, it will be 0.025. And now when we multiply that by 100, this is 100 millimeters across, so we get 2.5 millimeters. And I don't have the gauge box, so this is a... I have measured, this one is parallel 14 millimeters, but it's actually 100 over. So this is set to 2.51 millimeters. And then I'm using again this very reliable Starrett tool here. And well, of course, again, everything is like like clinically clean. And now I should be able to turn this around. Obviously it's not at the moment. You need to put it there. And then I check that both sides are tight. And that I have this here tight. It looks like I would like to get it a little bit more far. Yeah, and then I measure it the other way around, just to make sure. Okay, looks like we have the Morse 2 taper now there. Okay, now I'm boring the Morse taper. I have checked that we have clearances all over. It's a very long stick out on this one. It is musical. And then I will advance in, in 0.5 hundredths of a millimeter advances. I don't want to take any heavy cuts to avoid distorting the alignment of this one. And let's see how it sings. First 0.5 hundredths of a millimeter. Here goes nothing. Oh, it's amazingly silent. This here will become an M20/1 thread. And this is so like it should. Yeah. Now. have a true hole there. Good. Okay, now here is the workpiece. I have already dialed it in. So let's check that it is really tight. 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 And tight. I have locked my carriage because I'm feeding with the compound. And then we need to check our travels and the speed. Speed is okay, I travel. Wrong way. Oh well. Seems to be the melody of this machine. Wrong direction. So now just let's touch. Okay. I know that this edge of this workpiece is highest. So I will start with, I think with, let's take 0.5 millimeter. Let's see how it goes. C, that's quite low speed, feet. I could even do with A, which is the fastest. Okay, let's go with that one. Just a starter for the pilot grill, which will be, well, I just quit. Yeah. Good. Okay, now I'm boring this all the way through straight. Not to the final dimension, but straight, because I will need to have the other side straight when I indicate it the other way around, when I turn this. So now, let's bore. And I hope it cleans up in one pass, but it might take several. I'm taking really, because this is so big stick out, I hope it doesn't squeal on me. No, it does. Very good. And it's a long stringy chip. Oh man. Well, it made a total difference on the surface finish. Oh yeah. But it was really badly chipped. Should be 42 millimeters, quite exactly. Well, we overshoot it by 1.5 hundredths of a millimeter according to this measurement. Moment exactly 23.80 millimeters. I am taking 0.2 millimeter cuts, and after the last cut should be 5
hundredths of a millimeter too little, so that's it. That should pretty much be it. So. I will be doing the measurements in every step. So now we should be quite exactly 24 millimeters. Well, at least this measurement gave me 24 millimeters. Surface is perfect. Hopefully the dimension as well is perfect. Okay. Seems like it is 46, 96 I mean. There it is, finally. So this was freezing cold. It's still like quite cold here, but not from down under there. It's one piece now. You cannot possibly get it out from there, and it's all the way there. Yes! Yay! It became a lot better this time.
First of all, the shrink fit went okay. Last time it decided to put itself half the way, and after that it didn't move whatever I did. Okay, that's one. And the straightness of the MOS2 taper, well, this is 10 times smaller runout, 10th of the runout of the other one. And well, there is more material now, there is a flange even. Well, like that. I hope, well, let's see how the surface finishes. Well, Beartang does a good job. And well, this is my test nut here at the moment, at the end. So all the dimensions are well, more accurate than with the previous version, and the reason is the chuck. Well, I'm used to operate a four-jaw chuck, then I can control it, and I'm the only person to blame if something is not concentric, for example. So, yeah. So, in the next episode of Finno-Ugric Machining, I would like to do something else for just something for fun. And let's see what it is. Yeah. Till then, see you!